These figures running through the streets in Switzerland's Lurchental Valley are called Chagata and are part of an ancient tradition leading up to the Roman Catholic holiday of Ash Wednesday. It's a boisterous tradition, with the Chagata chasing children and teasing adults. Whoever gets caught by them gets pushed down or rubbed with snow. Apparently, it used to be even rougher in the past, and only single men were Chagata. But times are changing, and now married men take part too. The Chagata are dressed in old clothes, or sacking, with a cowbell pulled tightly around the middle. Huge shoulder pads are used to add bulk, and then a sheep or goat skin is put on top. The crowning glory is the carved, demonic-looking wooden masks. These special masks are carved by Agnes Rieder, who, although not a native of the valley, has played a large part in stimulating the Chagata tradition and keeping it alive. She's been carving masks here for 25 years. The masks cost between 500 and 2,000 francs each and take about 50 hours of work to complete. For Agnes Rieder, it's work she loves.
Sometimes I think it's like an addiction, like smoking or drinking.
This wood is so beautifully soft,
and when you have the right amount of imagination, you can do so many different things.
In her cellar, Agnes Rieder displays over 300 of her demonic masks, the origins of which are obscure. About 120 years ago, the church banned the masks and imposed a 50-cent fine for anyone caught wearing them. But the Chagata tradition and a rebellious streak in the nature of the Lurchental Valley inhabitants have made sure that this tradition still survives and flourishes today.
Carnival Sunday at Evolene. Early morning, people are being stuffed with straw. The participants are slid into costumes made from jute sacks that have been handed down from father to son for centuries and which are then stuffed with straw. The operation requires help from two people who shake the person being stuffed so as to distribute the layers evenly. It's a unique and totally bizarre custom.
Down through the centuries, they've been doing this a long time. It's been known for ages.
For years, a good 10 people have to suffer the straw torment. What does it feel like in there?
At the moment, there's nothing. We'll find out soon.
And you don't look very comfortable.
Yes, I am. I'm comfortable. I'll know better tomorrow, but for the time being, it's fine.
Why'd you do it?
It's a tradition, that's all. It's just that we're from Evolene.
When the straw man falls down, he can't get up. So what's the weight of the straw inside the costume?
In the large ones, there's about 25 to 28 kilos.
What do you feel?
You feel an enormous sense of pleasure when you take it off.
Once the stuffing with straw is finished, the disguise is completed by the mask, and the straw man, walking in a manner that deserves a language all of its own, sets off to attack the village. As people leave church, it's mostly the girls they prefer to terrify. Gigantic and unwieldy, for just a push would make them topple over, these straw men are terrifying, yet create a totally unique atmosphere. There they flicker, the first flames which will soon bring the whole of Liestal out in a sweat. It's 7 o'clock in the evening. Little Justin is the youngest of the blazing broom bearers. Only 4 years old, he's lighting his own broom just like the grown-ups. Aren't you scared to carry this?
Oh no. I have protective shoulder pads.
Nevertheless, Justin's broom weighs some 2 to 3 kilos. Despite tradition, playing with fire is never something to be taken lightly. 120 firemen, 40 first aiders and 40 policemen are on duty throughout Liestal. Their job is to keep people and flames under control.
It looks more dangerous than it really is. It's all been tested and tried, and the teams are very experienced. Nothing should actually happen. I can only switch off completely when the procession has gone off totally accident-free.
All in all, around 270 men, women and children are en route with blazing brooms this evening. How heavy is this thing?
I guess about 30 kilos.
And you'll manage to carry it in flames until 9, half past 9 for so long?
According to the rules, you have to carry it in one go for 100 meters. That's the rule. Isn't it dangerous?
No, I hope not.
What does I hope not mean?
Well, we've got the right clothing, so it should be okay.
And so they set off. A total of some 600 meters across the town of Liestal. 50,000 spectators have turned up, and they really heat up, in the true sense of the word. The broom bearers, almost to the point of exhaustion.
Why'd you put yourself through this?
I ask myself that every time.
Why'd you do it, honestly?
I don't know. The fascination of fire, to achieve something, together in a group. It's fun, but it's sheer torture.
How many holes have you already got in your jacket?
Enough, but now it's hot. I've got to go.
Most spectacular are the huge blazing wagons spaced out at intervals in the procession through the lanes. It's hellishly hot and smoky, sometimes almost unbearable for spectators and people in the procession.
It's hard, very hot, horribly hot, but it's been worse.
The Liestal gate has to endure the most heat and flames. The fire brigade have to douse it with water over and over again.
The smoke, the dust, the fire, the heat. How can you stand it?
You have to. It's awful, but we manage.
I'm no pyromaniac or I'd stand on the street, but this sort of tradition fascinates me.
And indeed, the roof-high flames of the blazing brooms procession are an ancient pagan custom. The burning flares put an end to winter and pave the way for spring. There have been no major problems in recent years, but nevertheless, the fire brigade in particular are always very pleased when the procession's over.
What a great relief. The pressure's off, but it isn't quite over yet. As you can see, our people are still at work. I'm happy it's gone off without any major incident again. We haven't had anything worth mentioning but large crowds because of the weather. All in all, we can say a successful blazing brooms procession.
The fire brigade remains on duty for a long time after the end of the procession. The last glowing embers of the burning wagons are finally extinguished at 2 a.m.
Wattenwil in Gürbetal, a village of 2,500 inhabitants to the west of Thun. A peaceful place, full of neat, solidly built houses. For the people of Wattenwil, this is not just any Monday. This is Hirsmontag, the Monday before Lent, a red-letter day in village life. But at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, there's hardly a trace of festival atmosphere, apart from the colourful flags. The streets are almost deserted. But just 1 hour later, everything looks quite different. The village comes to life. The long wait for the procession begins. Hirsmontag is a true Wattenwil tradition. Tradition says that as all married male citizens receive a share of wood from communal land every year, bachelors shall also receive something at least every 10 years. And so the president of the citizens' council gives them a fir tree to be sold to the highest bidder. The fir is some 160 years old, 26 meters high, and raises 4,300 Swiss francs, an impressive price. The proceeds go to the village's 111 bachelors and the colourful Hirsmontag festivities. The fir tree is then hauled halfway through the valley, from village to village and tavern to tavern. People taking part in the procession have a long, tiring day to get through before they arrive back at the Vattenville village square. But then they get an enthusiastic reception from local people. Hauling the fir tree on Hirs Montag is a mixture of carnival, a rarity in Protestant Bern, and a spring custom celebrating fertility in the home, field and forest. Traditional costumes such as the Zapfenmannli or fir cone creature, parish priest and doctor are all part of the colourful scene. Despite some touching scenes, Hirs Montag is certainly not for sensitive souls. You can reckon with a cold shower from the fire brigade, even at these wintry temperatures. Or would you prefer a handful of sawdust in your mouth? In any event, you won't get away without some black gunk on your face. This mixture of soot and shoe wax stings eyes and skin, but spectators need very strong nerves otherwise too. After a short breather, festival fun continues at the Restlisal restaurant in the evening. In earlier days, you'd always hear wedding bells ringing on Hirs Montag evening, but getting married isn't quite so trendy today. A hot meal soon revives some revelers. And with lots of single girls around, there'll be plenty of activity on the dance floor.
Drum rolls, torches and lanterns create the right atmosphere for the procession through the alleyways of Mendrisio. People dress up in costumes borrowed from Milan's Scala Opera House, each playing the part of one of the biblical figures who accompanied Christ on his way to Golgotha. The procession has followed the same pattern for more than 200 years. For many visitors, the reenactment of the Way of the Cross is simply an impressive spectacle, but for the people of Mendrisio, these scenes mean much more.
It still moves me as much as it did the first time. The procession is simply beautiful. It means a great deal to me. I have attended the procession ever since I was a child. That's 50 years of history for me.
This here is my life. That's why I bring my children here too. My late husband twice had the honor of playing Jesus. A dream for many men in Mendrisio, once in their lives, to be allowed to carry the heavy cross like Jesus, almost for Jesus.
In Val des Remonts, Canton Valais, the winter lasts 6 months, just as it does in all mountain valleys. For these mountain dwellers, Easter is more than just the celebration of Christ's resurrection. It is the time when new life is breathed into nature. In Valais, it has been the custom since the 16th century to celebrate the return of better times with a gift of food to the poor at Easter. These gifts to the poor, which meant so much in the past, have today been reduced to a tourist attraction. Local people and visitors alike can enjoy eating bread that has been blessed, some cheese, or a glass of wine. The Gelandemarkt Boys Parade on the 1st of March is a noisy custom primarily observed in Engadine, as well as the Bergell, Münstertal and Oberhalbstein valleys of Graubünden. The Graubünden Gelandemarkt was originally a custom to mark the changing year, but has for a long time now been associated with spring. On the day of the festival, the patroons wake up the bell ringers at 4 in the morning. They also ring their bells under the windows of their womenfolk, who have a packet of caramels tied with red ribbon, ready as a gift. All the boys gather at 7 o'clock. They clang their bells as they parade past the houses and then sing the traditional words of the Gelandemarkt song, set to music in 1899 by Otto Barblen. As a thank you, the townspeople present the singers with gifts. Let the young ladies take a little rest. They have a long way to go. The bunches of flowers are properly arranged. The parasol is there to protect the elegantly pale skin on the walk ahead. These proud ladies know precisely what period they've slipped into for the day. And why did you choose Rococo?
Because I wanted to wear a wig.
And the young Mozarts too present their costume with pride.
Underneath is the stand-up collar, then the waistcoat, and finally the jacket with breeches, and underneath you wear stockings.
They're between 5 and 15 years old, the main participants in the Sechserleuten Children's Parade in the centre of Zurich. Some are so excited that they simply forget to go on moving, while others seize the opportunity to hand out flowers to their fans lining the street. The children are looked after by the ladies' committee of the Zurich Guilds.
There's a wide range of children. A large proportion come from this year's guest canton. Some are children of guild members, and then there are a whole lot who have no connection with the guilds at all. School children from the canton or the city of Zurich.
Children from 14 different countries show off the traditional costumes of their homelands. These in the rickshaw have come from Indonesia, or these have arrived in Zurich from the guest canton Graubünden, dozens of them swinging their traditional bells. And at the end of the parade, watching over it all, comes the Berg, making his last journey to his place of execution. He has barely another 22 hours to live. The next day, the fire is lit at exactly 6 o'clock following the parade of the 26 guilds. To the cheers of the crowd and amidst the loud banging of the firecrackers, the symbol of winter explodes and collapses. As the flames reach the Berg, each of the mounted guilds rides three times round the fire. A lot of people have made their way to the town hall square in Surser this afternoon for the tradition of cutting down the goose. Nobody knows exactly where the custom comes from. A beautiful autumn day, the proverbial martini, or as we'd say, Indian summer, just what you'd wished for this Suisei event. The dead goose is hung up by its neck. Excitement mounts. How long will it take until it falls this time? Promptly at 3:15, the first candidate steps onto the stage. To make it more difficult for him to get his bearings, he's first spun round a little before he can, hopefully, strike the decisive blow. Well placed. But this time the goose stays in one piece. Before the next strike is ready, public interest is captured by the younger girls and boys who try to climb a pole to grab a package at the top. And that's the first winner of the St. Martin's Day in Suisei. Meanwhile, two would-be goose cutters have failed in their attempts. The excitement mounts. It's getting time for the goose to fall. At last it happens. The delighted winner is revealed and duly applauded. And naturally, he gets to keep the goose.
Year in, year out, the Bernese onion market starts in the early hours of the morning on the fourth Monday in November. As the name implies, the main items on sale are braided strings of onions. Since the 15th century, both locals and visitors have mingled together at the Martinmas market, today's onion market. Countless extra trains and coaches bring thousands of visitors to the capital. The onion market doesn't grow in size. The number of stores remains the same. There just isn't any more space in town. In Altdorf, the carnival procession is a deafening din of brass bands, countless fantasy instruments, and over 100 big drums. This is the noise to be heard at 4:00 in the morning on the last Thursday before Lent. Here is the big marching drum, known in Switzerland as the Pauke. It comes especially into its own in Altdorf at carnival time. The musicians always play the same piece, the Bourbaki March. The tempo is slow, very slow.
The central character in the Lucerne Carnival is Bruder Fritschi, a masked figure who was first mentioned in 1443. The Lucerne Carnival begins on Schmutziger Donnerstag, the Thursday before the beginning of Lent, at 5:00 in the morning, with the Urknall, the Big Bang. In the afternoon, the carnival parade of the Fritschi Guild is held. The second Lucerne Guild, the Weizunft, is in charge of the parade on Carnival Monday. Gurken musicians have played at the Lucerne Carnival since 1950. These are brass ensembles accompanied by numerous percussion instruments and drums, playing anything as long as it's off-key. They all meet at the Gurken Music Monster Concert on Tuesday evening. Before this, all the carnival groups and numbers of masked individuals can be seen showing themselves off all over town.
Déjà c'est la nuit sur Rio, entends-tu sonner les tambours. Viens mon ami, il faut danser, nous danserons tout le jour.
The origin of this custom has to be found in the countless secular festivals linked to the month of May. The general rule is that each song merits a reward.
They had no more rolls of 50 centime coins at the post office this morning, so I had to do it differently, but it's fine. The bowl is ready. It's a very pretty custom in the sense that it marks the coming of spring. So, well, the sun, being able to live outdoors, cheerfulness.
A custom that also pays off. On average, each child can expect to collect 100 francs between now and this evening. The children have all day for it. There's no school today.
You sang well.
How much will you have altogether at the end of the day?
That depends. I once got 90 francs.
It's a well-known saying, time is money, and these boys have learnt it well. They made their rounds this morning on bikes. In the early 19th century, shooting clubs from Entlebuch in Canton Lucerne and from the Bernese Emmental used to meet up for shooting tournaments. During these competitions, the marksmen were obliged to appear in female company. The women would have some gifts ready, which they would hand over to the men if they'd done well. During the 19th century, women also occasionally tried their hand at shooting. By the 1930s, around 100 women took part in shooting tournaments. The community and women's shooting tournament takes place in Entlebuch every 3 years in May. The shooting takes place over 4 days, but on the fifth day, the celebrations reach a high point when a mass is held and the different shooting clubs gather for a ceremony to announce the shooting results and to crown the new Schützenkönig and Schützenkönigin, the king and queen of shooting. Not just household implements, but also tools, including the flail, have been turned into musical instruments. Threshing is hard work, and in the past, to lighten the load, workers used to thresh in time, using verses as a way of remembering the rhythms. For instance, we must thresh, ever faster, pay the debts of our masters. The task of threshing corn gave rise to a custom in Halville in Canton Aargau. On New Year's Eve, a board is flailed to symbolize the old year being beaten out and the new being beaten in. Perhaps the people of Halville have forgotten the original use of the flail. It's a part of me. The Sylvester Clausen is a custom that we enjoy and want to see continue. Every year we enter into the spirit of it.
A lot of work goes into the costumes. The group spent 2 years working on their new headdresses. Every creation is unique. The ornate headdresses and costumes made of fir branches pull in the visitors, but Canton Appenzell's Silvesterklausen or New Year festival is no Swiss invention. The custom originated in monastery schools in France. The people of Ornach say they learned to love this custom as babies, and that is why it has never died out.
I'd say it's something that lies dormant within us and is awakened and comes to life every new year. It's something very special.
There are around 30 Silvesterklausen groups in Ornach, and the younger generation are already showing an interest.
The journey back into the Middle Ages begins as daylight fades. 800 people in historical costume are processing through the old city of Geneva to commemorate the Escalade.
It was one of Geneva's great battles 400 years ago, so that makes it special. It's important to remember the Escalade, to keep history alive, pass it on to the next generation, and not to forget, even if there are other more important things happening in the world today.
But when it happened in 1602, it was a sensation in Europe. The Duke of Savoy, Charles Emmanuel, wanted to bring Geneva under his rule. In the night of December the 11th, 1602, he launched an attack with 2,000 soldiers. While the city slept, the attackers climbed over walls, hence the name Escalade, referring to their ladders. But the sleepers awoke, and soldiers and townspeople managed to repulse the attack in the space of a few hours. The death toll, 18 Genevans and 70 of the enemy. Mère Royaume is the most important person in the procession. She is said to have killed one of the enemy soldiers with her cooking pot. Her pot is today the symbol of the Escalade.
For Geneva, the victory meant independence and freedom, and today we are celebrating Geneva and its independence.
So in celebrating the Escalade, Geneva is also celebrating itself. People remember the centuries when Geneva was a city-state and defied the great powers. They celebrate Geneva as a special case, which it hasn't quite stopped being even now, although it has become part of Switzerland.
The custom of holding a spring festival to commemorate the Battle of Nefels on April 9, 1388, has been decreed an annual event by the authorities in Glarus. On that day, no one in Canton Glarus goes to work. Wind ensembles, the cantonal choral union, the senior cantonal official, church representatives, and members of the public gather every 9th of April south of Nefels at the first memorial stone commemorating the battle. The story of the battle is retold. Afterwards, everyone walks from one commemorative stone to the next until they reach Nefels. In even years, a Protestant pastor delivers the address, while in odd years, it's the turn of a Catholic priest. The day ends with a market and dancing.
In Bellinzona, Lugano, Locarno and Ascona, in Canton Ticino, risotto is prepared in giant cauldrons on Carnival Tuesday. The risotto is not handed out for free, but the proceeds from selling it are given to charity. Ha ha ha! In the cantonal capital, Bellinzona, Carnival Sunday sees the arrival of Rabadan, the prince of the carnival.
A lively start to the last night of the Payan Carnival. More than 200 female revelers known as chineurs or manhunters have been going up and down the streets of Payan, moving from bar to bar. Disguised and masked, most of them young, they're taking advantage of their anonymity to have a laugh at the men's expense.
No one recognizes us, so we can do what we want. We cuddle up to them, they all like it, they love it when we come. We go into a bar, ask someone to dance, and we dance. After a few drinks, we wind up the guys.
That must be the caretaker of our block of flats. It's bound to be her, the caretaker of the block of flats.
I'm trying to make him guess who I am.
I got it completely wrong.
He won't discover the identity of this manhunter this evening. This custom, which continues year after year, originated about a century ago.
It's a way for them, under the cover of their masks, to tell some home truths to the elders of the town, to the people we have elected, so that they hear it one way or another. And this custom has continued in Payan.
The festival was followed for the rest of the long night by the sound of Gukka music. Dressed as nuns, rabbits and elephants, the women continued to rag the boyar men.